Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to First United Methodist Church, Fairfield. We are so glad that you have joined us in worship this morning on this blessed and beautiful morning. If you would, please register your attendance in the red folios on the inside of the pews and pass it to the person next to you. Also, if you're visiting this morning, welcome. And if you will, please complete the white card in the pew back in front of you and place it in the offertory place. It comes before you later in the service. Or there is a QR code on the back of the bulletin that will direct you to a page on our website that lists all the opportunities and ways that you can participate in the activities and ministries of the church. If you would, please refer to today's bulletin for the listing of upcoming events this week and the weeks ahead. The Upstream Small Groups Bible Studies and Fellowship will be meeting this evening at 6 p.m. at Will and Courtney Dreyer's home. If you don't know where Will and Courtney Dreyer live, reach out to Pastor Mike and he'll be happy to give you directions and instructions on how to get there. But that's at 6 p.m. Tomorrow, April 8th, the trustees will meet at 5:30 p.m. in the Fellowship Hall, and our Grief Share Ministry will meet at 6 p.m. at the Parsonage next door. I'd also like to remind you that our graduating seniors, their scholarship packets are due by 4 p.m. tomorrow. So if you have a graduating senior that would like to apply for the scholarship, they need to get their packet into the church office by close of business tomorrow. The UMW will meet at 10 a.m. on Tuesday, April 9th in the youth area upstairs. We continue our Methodist midweek mission on Wednesday, April 10th. Dinner will be served at 5:30, and Bible studies, youth, and other activities will go from 6 to 7. These are all great opportunities to join and participate and be a part of the ministries of the church, and we invite you to attend and join in for our Christian fellowship and discipleship. Now, I would like to take a moment to thank our youth director, Andrea Roller, and all the parents and adult leaders that made today's delicious breakfast possible. What a gift of service and opportunity. What a great gift of service and opportunity to spend time together in Christian fellowship. So God bless you all. Now let us turn our hearts and minds towards God as we go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we come to you this morning praying that you continue to stir our hearts and quiet our minds while pouring out your Holy Spirit upon us. As we stand together singing your praise and celebrating your greatness now and forevermore, we ask this in your holy and precious name.
Amen.
Now would you please stand if you're able and lift your voices and join in singing our first hymn this morning, "A Mighty Fortress Is Our God," which can be found on page 110 in your hymnals. Let us sing together.
Thank you.
Corinthians 8:88 in your hymnals. Let us join as we affirm our faith together. This is the good news which we have received, in which we stand, and by which we are saved. Christ died for our sins, was buried, was raised on the third day, and appeared first to the women, then to Peter and the 12, and then to many faithful witnesses. We believe Jesus is the Christ, the anointed one of God, the firstborn from the dead, in whom all things hold together, in whom the fullness of God was pleased to dwell by the power of the Spirit. Christ is the head of the body, the church, and by the blood of the cross reconciles all things to God. Amen.
Logistics down eventually, seeing as it is the first Sunday. But it is a joy to have that ministry back up and running. Amen?
Amen.
Brothers and sisters, we have been redeemed through Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen?
Let us now stand and celebrate in that revelation by passing the peace of Christ amongst us this morning.
Thank you.
next hymn this morning is God Will Take Care of You, which can be found on page 130 in your hymnals. Let us stand and sing together.
Single daddy it since Thursday. And I say again, I am very, very thankful and joyful for my wife. I'm excited she's coming home tomorrow.
Softball team, sir.
Okay. Be in prayer for all our youth that are involved. Brothers and sisters, let us now go into a time of prayer, and I would remind you that if there is a concern you would like to lift up, you are free to do so audibly, and we will respond with, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Father God, we give you thanks for this day, for it is a day of your creation. Lord, we ask in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, that tomorrow be a safe day, be a day in which everyone comes out and enjoys, and everyone gets home safely. We ask that you be with all of those in our community and our church who are traveling. Hold them in the palm of your hand and shield them from any weariness or any difficulty or any terror. We ask that tomorrow be an experience for all of those that is joyful and memorable in positive ways. And Father, we lift up to you the concerns that we have upon our souls and upon our hearts at this time. Lord, in your mercy.
For each person listed in our bulletin.
Lord, in your mercy. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, in your mercy.
Scripture reading this morning comes from 1 Peter. It's the story of praising to God for a living hope. This is the word of God. Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to God's elect, exiles scattered throughout the provinces of Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, Bithynia, who have been chosen according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, through the sanctifying work of the Spirit, to be obedient to Jesus Christ and sprinkled with his blood. Grace and peace be yours in abundance. Praise be to God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. In all this, you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have had to suffer grief and all kinds of trials. These have come so that the proven genuineness of your faith, of greater worth than gold which perishes, even though refined by fire, may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Though you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy, for you are receiving the end result of your faith, the salvation of your souls. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Zealousness without fear in which he preaches is totally contrary to the people. on the world at this time. He addresses specific congregations in specific regions, and we believe he's actually addressing predominantly Gentiles in his conversation. But he uses rhetoric and language that is very Jewish in its tone. Why is that? Well, we believe that the reason why he uses it is he is reminding or assuring the Gentiles that they are now part of God's covenant. They are now part of the same history of the Jewish people, that they continue in the line of God's promise to his people. That's why when people tell me that the Old Testament isn't all that important, or that the stories of the Old Testament aren't as important as the stories of the New Testament, no, no, no. The Old Testament is just as much our story as it is their story of the past. We needed that story to get to Jesus. And we were included in that same conversation of faith. We are the continuation of the gospel message. And the gospel message began with Genesis chapter 1, verse 1. It continues to this day with us. Now, interestingly, it doesn't sound too much like a persecution letter to begin with. He's being very upbeat. He's talking and he's saying, be hopeful, be joyful. But we know that it is a persecution letter because he says, Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to God's elect exiles scattered throughout the provinces of Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. And throughout these selection of scriptures, we see little flips and phrases of individuals. We see terms like who through faith are shielded by God's power. Though now for a little while you may have to suffer grief of all kinds, as in verse 6. I think the powerful aspect of this scripture, one of the most powerful phrases is, praise be, this is verse 3, praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you. Those are comforting words to someone who is enduring persecution. So, let's set the tone. Let's talk about persecution. Now, I'm going to disappoint some of you today, because I think many of you would want to hear a sermon about all the ways the church in our country today is being persecuted. All the ways in which the government is oppressing us Christians here today. I'm going to let you in on a personal opinion of mine. I don't think we as a local church here in Fairfield, Texas have too much to worry about persecution. I have very much less faith in the fact that our government is capable of doing anything such organized as that persecution in Fairfield, Texas, as much less anything else in this world. Sorry, didn't mean to go off on that tangent, but that's just my thought. But here's the issue that I have. Most of the time when people come up to me as a pastor and say, Mike, we're being persecuted as Christians, and then they point to an example of Christian persecution here in the United States, I just don't feel like we know what persecution really is. I don't feel like we, at least in our community, truly comprehend what persecution actually is. I'm going to let that sit there. The persecution in which 1 Peter is addressing is persecution in which people's lives are in danger. Their livelihoods are threatened. Every facet of their lives is on a thread. When was the last time we saw our ministers being dragged out of their pulpits and through the streets, beaten and thrown in prison? When was the last time we saw armed troops kicking the doors of churches and tossing in Molotov cocktails? When was the last time with orders from the government saying you cannot meet. When does that happen in Fairfield? The reality is that the persecution in which we read about in 1 Peter in the first century of the Christian community is far beyond our comprehension. And yet those of you who have traveled outside this country, those of you who have gone beyond our shores, you can attest that persecution is very real in other places. When the confessing of Jesus as your Savior is punishable by death, punishable by imprisonment, punishable by the removal of all livelihood and riches. Some of you have seen persecution. And once you have seen it, you know it for the evil that it is. No, I'm not saying we don't face persecution here. I think we face persecution of a different evil. I think we face a persecution that is much harder to contain in some ways. It's sometimes easy when you can see the enemy and know who he is. They wear a uniform, or they fly a flag. No, the persecution I want to talk to you about today, one that I think is more prevalent for our local community, is the persecution that comes from within. The persecution in which we bestow upon ourselves, and the persecution with which we bestow upon each other. Now, here's a little disclaimer. We're not going to be comfortable when we leave here today, because it wasn't comfortable for me to write this sermon. I wanted to focus on all the other persecution stuff. That's fun. Fun's not the right word. Shouldn't use that word. That's easier. But instead, I wanted to focus on something that I think is truly affecting members of our congregation this morning. Truly affecting members that are sitting in our pews right here and right now. And that is the issue of inner and localized persecution. The persecution that we bring upon ourselves because we refuse to fully grasp just how forgiving and graceful our God is. How many of you are sitting here today continually and constantly haunted by the mistakes of your past? How many of you are sitting here today still trying to earn your way into God's good grace? How many of you, if you were here today, if the pastor said, if you trusted the pastor, came up and said, if you get $50 right now, I can guarantee you a place in heaven, there would be that small part of you that would consider writing that $50 check. Just to have that assurance. As human beings, we are broken people in need of mending. And we refuse at times to acknowledge that the mending that comes from Jesus Christ can be as simple as it is. We are continuously trying to buy our way into the grace of God. We are continually trying to earn the grace that was given. I once had someone tell me, Pastor Mike, I just want to be able to deserve the ability to be a Christian. I want to be able to deserve to sit in here on Sunday morning. I got news for you. None of us deserve to be here. Let me say that again. None of us deserve to be here. And I certainly don't deserve to be wearing this, and I don't deserve to be preaching from that. We don't deserve to be singing praise and hymns. We don't deserve to take communion. None of us are deserving of that. in the kingdom of God. You don't earn it. You don't pay for it. It's given to you. The other aspect of persecution that we see in the church today is the persecution of each other. The persecution of the people sitting next to us in church. You see, what I've discovered is that when people are in places of great comfort, they usually try to find something to fight about. When everything's going good, or everything's at least in a place of privilege, we try to find things that we can argue about, because who wants to be at peace? We all know that person, right? We all know that person that would go out right now and buy a lottery ticket. Now, this is not, I'm not telling you to go buy a lottery ticket. This is not me condoning gambling. But let's say, we all know that friend that would go out and buy a lottery ticket, and he'd win $5 million, and the first thing that he'd say is, well, I gotta give some of that back to the government. Oh, but you're gonna have $4 million. Well, my taxes are gonna go all down. Or that person, every year it happens. What are we hearing? What is the big prayer request come summertime? Rain. Rain. We need rain. We need rain. And yet, you know there'll be that one person that after we get a gutter washing over rain that breaks any drought, goes, well, I'm grateful for the rain, but I wish it hadn't all come down at the same time. How can you be a Christian and have that mentality? How can you be a Christian and only see the despair and the issue? Friends, if you look for problems in this world, you've got to find them. You look for problems in the church, you've got to find them. You look for problems in your family, you've got to find them. The question becomes, what are the problems we can live with because we are human beings? Because we are sinful, because we all recognize that the reason we're here in the first place is because we need a relationship with Jesus Christ. That's what brings us into this house. At least I hope that's what brings you into this house. We acknowledge that. And what are the things that we can't truly sit with? And I'm here to tell you that most of the time, and often the time, 99% of the time, the church is bombarded with issues in which we can work through them by the power of Christ. It's easier, though, to persecute. It's easier, though, to neglect. It's easier, though, to reject. Maybe I'm going to be saying too much here, but I'm always really, really frustrated when God puts people in my life who desperately need love and care. They turn out to be some of the most annoying people in the world. You ever see that person that you're walking down and you're like, oh, I don't want to talk to that person. Oh my gosh, oh, they made eye contact. But let me ask you this. Could you possibly be that person's one interaction with Jesus today? Could you possibly be that one moment where they get a break from all the pressures and negativity that's on their shoulders? Friends, we persecute ourselves. We don't need a government to persecute us. We don't need powers and authorities in our community to persecute us. We do it enough to ourselves. The devil doesn't need to send an army. He's got us to do it to ourselves. We refuse to accept the gift of grace and love. Let me share something. Because it starts in a small place and it expands because people don't do anything when they have the ability to make a direct impact. When the Nazis had come to power, if every single church had said, no, stop, this isn't right. Part of the reason for this sermon, part of the reason I've been drawn to 1 Peter, because it is a book written to the persecuted Christians, is I have seen in the eyes and in the shoulders and in the very countenance of my membership great burdens that are being borne and carried for no reason. Shame, frustration, anger, and an inability to see the goodness of God even in the midst of all that we deal with in this world. Friends, the world's always been this way. I'm sorry to say it. The world's always been this way. There was never a golden time. The 1950s had colored-only signs outside their doors. The roaring 20s had moonshine. The 1980s had music from the 1980s. It's always been a mess. The thing that separates us from the mess is the acknowledgement that we have been forgiven. We have been restored. And that we have the ability to share the one message that can bring hope to the hopeless. And that our place in the kingdom has been secured through Jesus Christ. As we journey through 1 Peter, my hope is that we begin to appreciate the sufferings of our predecessors. Peter said it best this morning when he said, again, sort of mimicking what Jesus said, you love Jesus even though you've never seen him. Do you realize that by sitting in here today and professing your faith in Jesus Christ, you actually possess more faith than the apostles? The apostles got to see the risen Lord. We only get to hear about it and see him in our experiences. The letter of 1 Peter and 2 Peter apply to those who suffer from persecution, and yet they still believe. So this morning, my challenge to you is to lay your burden down and don't take it back up. Become a tool, become an individual, become a community that is able to be wielded by Jesus Christ as an effective hammer blow against the ways of evil. If he can create a Christian church through men like Peter, a sword-wielding, water-dropping-drowning, foot-in-mouth zealot, then surely he can use us in this house this morning. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. If I could have those that are going to be assisting with communion come forward at this time. you please open your hymnals to page 13? The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
It is, let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join in our unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery and sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which Christ gave himself up for us, he took the bread and he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples and he said, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks over it. He gave it to his disciples and he said, "Take and drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, put out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ is dying. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Please bow your heads and pray. Holy Lord, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us gathered here in all these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be one in your church and in communion, until Christ comes in final victory, and we feast his heavenly banner. Amen. My friends, this is the Lord's table. You do not have to be a member of our congregation to join us here this morning. You must simply come seeking Christ. We use just plain bread and grape juice, not wine. But I invite the choir to come forward at this time, and I invite the congregation to come forward as the ushers call.
God, we thank you for your love and your grace. Father, we ask that you continue to lead us and guide us in all that we do. Father, we know that you equip those that you call, not call the equipped. Let us be your hands and your feet in spreading your love and your light throughout the world so that others may come closer to you. Father, we thank you for all the many blessings you have and continue to bestow upon each of us. And we ask you to be with us now as we prepare to give a portion of these gifts for the betterment of your kingdom. It's in your holy and precious name we pray, as all God's people said.
stay on for today. And so when I paid for your check and see if it was me, and I don't know if I'm down, he said,